Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I please ask everybody to ensure that all electronic devices are switched to silent. Our first item of business is to consider whether to take item 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item of business today is to continue our follow-up inquiry into salmon farming in Scotland by hearing from the Fish Health Inspectorate. The Fish Health Inspectorate are part of the Marine Directorate of the Scottish Government and are tasked with monitoring compliance with aquaculture health regulations. And I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting Charles Allen, the Group Leader at the Fish Health Inspectorate. Also joining us today is Edward Mounting, MSP, and I'll bring you in at the end of the members' questions to ask your questions. Do you have any relevant interest to declare, Mr. Mountain?
Yes, Convener. They are fully declared in my register of interest, but to be clear, I jointly own a wild fishery on the River Spey, which is on the east coast of Scotland. The fishery employs 3 full-time employees and provides fishing on a let basis. I don't believe that there's an interest or a conflict of interest in that there are no cages off the River Spey or on the east coast of Scotland. So full details are in my register of interest, Camina.
Thank you. So we'll kick off the questions with a nice straightforward question you'll be pleased to hear. Can I ask you to briefly outline the key functions of the Fish Health Inspectorate and how you work and interact with industry, with the Scottish Government and other regulators?
Our primary role is the control of listed disease, so prevention of listed pathogens entering the country, and where listed disease outbreaks do occur, their control and in many cases eradication. We have wider role beyond listed disease with regard to regulation of sea lice as far as it equates to aquaculture animals, containment of fish. We provide a diagnostic service to industry and to the wild fisheries, whether that is fishery boards or trusts. We collect on behalf of Veterinary Medicines Directorate mussel samples for analysis of veterinary medicine residues. And as far as import and export are concerned, we provide advice, information and certification to allow that trade to occur.
Can I ask, do you see your service as more reactive or proactive?
I would say we are both. We have a risk-based surveillance schedule which grinds on year by year. I have inspectors out on farm pretty much every week of the year. We have inspectors on call. So both proactive, we're out looking, and reactive, where incidents occur, we are called and will attend.
Thank you. Can I ask a question from Beatrice Wishart?
Thanks. Good morning, Mr. Allen. The REC Committee inquiry noted concern that enforcement action in relation to breaches of sea lice levels had not been sufficiently robust, and the report recommended that it must be robust, enforceable and include appropriate penalties. So do you believe that the enforcement regime has improved since that report?
I'll answer that in two ways. One, I think the sea lice situation on farm in Scotland has changed significantly since that report. We have new reporting requirements in place, and in my opinion, and in the opinion of lawyers, the enforcement action which is taken is related to the requirement of the law. Many people think that high sea lice numbers, for example, are something which are directly punishable. It's a direct offence. It's not. The requirement of the law is that the farmers have satisfactory measures in place to control, minimise and prevent sea lice infestations. Where those measures are deemed not to be satisfactory, that's the point of law where regulation kicks in. and the law would require me, where it is not satisfactory, to serve an improvement notice on the farmer. Where the farmer does not comply with that improvement notice or enforcement notice, that is the point at which a file could be produced and presented to Procurator Fiscal for consideration for prosecution. So, in my opinion, the law is satisfactory and reasonable to reach the point of compliance which Scottish Government seek to achieve, which is a satisfactory measure of control. We have served enforcement notices and farmers have complied with them, so we have never taken a file for prosecution or for consideration for prosecution to procurators.
Are you able to give any indication of kind of numbers of enforcement or where you've looked at enforcement?
We have to accept that subsequent to previous inquiry, the reporting requirements changed. And we have seen with a change in that reporting requirement, sea lice numbers come down on farm. In the last year, we have offered no enforcement notices. In previous years, we offered more enforcement notices.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you. Just to pick up on what Beatrice Wishart is asking about enforcement regime and how the Rural Committee report recommended changes and moving away from the self-assessment culture to then an independent approach to assessment and then enforcement, for instance. Can you tell us a little bit about the efforts that have been made to move to a more independent monitoring process?
At the time of the previous inquiry, as part of that assessment of satisfactory measures, there was a reporting limit and an intervention limit, which sat initially at a reporting level of 3 and an intervention level of 8. And only those farms which are above the reporting level then had subsequent requirements to report sea lice. As a direct result, I think, of the previous inquiry, the legislation has changed. An order has put in place that all farms require to report sea lice on a weekly basis, which gives us, as the regulator, a far greater sight of what is occurring on farm. Not only do they report their sea lice numbers every time we are on site carrying out inspections for whatever purpose, we will audit a number of records, one of which is the site sea lice record. And we will then assess the accuracy of that report versus what is empirically observed on the farm.
OK, thanks.
Rachel Hamilton.
Nice to see you giving evidence this morning, Mr. Allen. We heard evidence last week that the sea lice situation was still very serious, and you had said that the sea lice situation has changed significantly. So I think the committee would like to understand, if you have the figures to hand, how many incidences have there been of the sea lice levels exceeding the mandatory number?
If my memory serves me correctly, I do have it, and I will find it before
yes.
I finish
okay.
my question.
So,
but
okay, well,
the previous intervention level of
yeah.
6 was only exceeded once in the last full reporting year.
Okay. Well, that leads me nicely on, whilst you perhaps look for those figures, is the number of enforcement actions that were taken. You described there that until the satisfactory measures in place were not demonstrated and then the situation was not satisfactory, that would lead you on to give an improvement notice, but then escalate that to the Procurator Fiscal. So what enforcement actions were taken and have there been any prosecutions for failure to reduce sea lice levels?
There have been no prosecutions for failure to reduce lice levels.
Can you explain to the committee the actual practicalities of going in, doing an inspection and then asking individual salmon farms to put in satisfactory measures and then for that improvement notice? Because this is all tied up in the next part of my question, which is around the no counts. And of course, there are a number of people who are not reporting for various reasons.
Okay. Satisfactory measures, although that, you know, the requirement of the law, satisfactory measures are continually being applied. Farmers are continually considering the lice populations on their fish and taking appropriate action to keep them within a satisfactory position with regard to the health of the fish on the site. Sea lice treatment is very much a balance. You have to consider the health of the fish, the population of the sea lice, the state of the environment, and the available tools which farmers have to deal with the sea lice presence. And we have seen a decrease in the availability of veterinary medicines, and farmers have had to apply other measures. So we have, you know, plain, straightforward husbandry practice and management. So fallowing of sites, single-year classes. There are a limited number of veterinary medicines which are available, which are consent to discharge is dealt with through CEPA, so there is a limited volume of veterinary medicines that they can use. Biological controls in the way of cleaner fish and physical processes, so bathing in fresh water, the application of hydrolysers and thermolysers. So there's a whole range of measures which farmers are taking routinely to control the lice populations on their fish. It is not simply because they are required to by law. It is a continuing husbandry operation.
But you did say that sea lice situation has changed significantly. So what did you mean by that if the mandatory situation hasn't actually made a difference?
I think management of sea lice on farm fish populations in Scotland has improved.
Okay.
And it may well be that the statutory driver for that improvement is a requirement to report lice by everybody on a weekly basis.
Okay, so is your approach then a little bit more carrot rather than stick by the sounds of it? Because if you had a situation, I mean, I would like this committee to understand the time frame of going in, inspecting, saying that things need to improve, then being satisfied, but also how many times do you then subsequently go back to that individual because the situation hasn't improved? Because it seems to me that looking at the data, you say that there'd been a breach at six, but there seems to be a more varied picture than that from just looking at the raw data, that there have been a number of breaches, more than you're describing, but that hasn't led to enforcement or to the referral to a procurator fiscal. So how long do you work out how long on average it takes for you to give somebody an opportunity to improve and to improve and to improve and to improve?
If I can come to a point you made first, am I more carrot than stick? As a regulator, if I have to apply the stick, that actually reflects very bad. I would see myself as a regulator having failed. My primary driver and the driver of the Scottish Government is to drive continuous improvement, to drive compliance. And where you come to the stick, you've actually failed to appropriately, in my view, to appropriately regulate. I would far rather drive compliance than seek prosecution. And your last point, you are correct. There is a progressive ramping of enforcement action. We would start with informal advice. That would then move to a formal warning letter. If the situation hadn't changed during that process, we would proceed to enforcement notice.
Okay. Maybe that's covered later on. Is it, convener? I just want to know the average time of the... I don't want to go into somebody else's questions. It's just...
Go ahead.
So have you worked out then what the average sort of time is for one of these commercial enterprises to actually get back to normality or to the threshold level? Is that possible? Are you monitoring that? Because that, if I was doing your job, I would be quite worried if, say, for example, it took somebody 12 months or 6 months to get to that stage.
We're nowhere close to that time period. One good treatment could take you from a point of enforcement back to absolutely satisfactory. It's very variable. But a good, effective treatment is key to demonstration of satisfactory measures.
Okay. I haven't really got much of a grasp of understanding how it actually works, I'm afraid, from your answers. I know that you're giving what you can, but can I move on just very briefly to the no counts? Because again, looking at the data, there are various, as you've described, reasons for individuals giving the no count as not, giving the data. Do you actually track the justification for describing a no count? How do you go to somebody and say, why, is it true that, because of weather conditions, or is it true because of, withdrawal periods, that these individuals haven't been able to give the data?
The simple answer is yes. You will be aware there are a number of reasons given for no count, and some of them are pretty much absolute. We don't require farmers to count the presence of sea lice on fish which have been very recently transferred from freshwater to seawater. There's a biological rationale for that, in that it takes time for sea lice populations to settle and mature through to adult female or a vigorous female. The fish are also very, very soft, so they're very prone to damage if you handle them. And to carry out sea lice counts at the moment, you're required to handle them. Weather generally is fairly straightforward to track. As I said, we've got inspectors out pretty much every week of the year in the farming regions. And we are as prone to, as fish farmers are, to being weathered off. There are days that we cannot get to sea to carry out inspections. Veterinary advice. I cannot go against the advice of the consulting veterinary practice or the consulting vet who has those animals under his clinical care. I cannot trump that, and I would not. The two areas which are of possibly more contention, one is where the farm is being treated. And I can understand the rationale why farmers wouldn't want to give me a count during that week. One, their staff are tied up carrying out the physical treatment. And two, the numbers will change during that treatment. Mm. But often farmers will count lice numbers directly after treatment and will submit those counts. The one which causes greatest discussion, I think, is stocks which are being held for harvest. At the moment, we count lice on fish by physically removing them from the environment, anaesthetising them and counting the lights. Those fish are then recovered and put back into the cage. And that anaesthetic has got a withdrawal period. You cannot offer those fish for sale during that period of withdrawal. So farmers will offer stocks withdrawn for harvest as a reason not to count lice on those fish. And we're attempting to minimise the number of no counts which are not carried out for the reason of harvest withdrawal.
Are you worried about the repeated no counts?
We, again, I would say no. Initially, there were a few sites where significant periods of time were covered by no counts. There have been a couple of very public discussions surrounding that. We have given assurance that that would not be repeated. We have spoken directly with the sector, and they have given assurance also that that would not be repeated. And it's something that we monitor on a weekly basis. It becomes very apparent in the data set where you start seeing sequential gaps.
That's right. Thank you.
Hey, Ariane Burgess has got a supplementary on this.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us. Just on the sea level, the 6 lice per fish, and my understanding is that that's to protect farm fish. One of our concerns is our wild salmon. And what I understand is that count is 12 times higher than the industry code of good practice. And that's being exceeded by 30 farms in recent weeks. And it's 30 times higher than Norway's mandatory level on all farms in the spring. And apparently Norway culls fish on farms that exceed 0.2 lice per fish in the spring in order to protect wild salmon. So I just wonder what your thoughts are on that, because obviously part of the recommendations of the report were about protecting Scotland's wild salmon.
The Aquaculture and Fisheries Scotland Act is very clearly directed at aquaculture stocks, and my regulatory function is with regard to that rather than the protection of wild fish. I'm not saying that there is no merit, but my regulatory boundary lies with the aquaculture animal.
So is there something that we need to do in terms of regulation in order to protect the wild salmon better than we are already, if you're bound in a particular box by this Act?
If I'm correct, CEPA are coming in a separate evidence session, and they have an entire regulatory framework which is considering sea lice and effects of sea lice on wild fish, okay, as emitted from fish farms.
So you see in your role as the Fish Health Inspectorate that you don't need to be aware of the issues to do with wild fish?
We are aware of it.
Or take action.
But we do not regulate with regard to the impact on wild fish.
Thanks.
Thank you. Just following up some of the evidence you provided to Rachel Hamilton there. During last week's committee evidence session, Wild Fish and Coastal Communities Network expressed concerns that no progress had been made in reducing sea lice levels and that no actions were sanctioned or sanctions were being applied to fish farms reporting high levels. From what you've said, you dispute that. That's not the case.
I would dispute that. I think significant progress has been made by the sector, both in their own right and by dint of carrot, to lead them in a particular direction. And I don't think that those efforts can be discounted.
Okay. Do you think those improvements are a result of better enforcement of counts and sanctions, or is it a general improvement in the industry's ability to deal with sea lice?
I think there are two things which have driven it. One is a requirement by all farmers to report every week. Public opinion and also almost a competitive nature to want to be better than your competitor is driving that. But also a very significant investment from the sector in next generation lice control strategies, particularly with regard to development of physical means. We're seeing changes in the mechanics of how physical sea lice treatment is carried out. A huge investment in reverse osmosis, so the production of fresh water in well boats. And something that I should actually have said in response to the no-count issue, what we are seeing is increased interest in automated sea lice counting. So high-resolution cameras in individual pens, and through the joy of AI, the ability of systems to actually recognise individual fish. So not only in recognising the individual fish, but being able to count the lice on those individual fish. Mm-hmm. So I have spoken with the producers of the technology and also with farmers who are interested in applying the technology. So that is, that I would see as next step in sea lice recording and reporting. Farmers' concern is how would that sit then with regard to the law and their requirement to report. And we have to satisfy ourselves that the counting technology is as good or better than the human eye.
Thank you. Can I just ask about, we've heard in previous sessions about some sites, physical sites, being more prone to sea lice higher sea lice populations. Do you have any role in looking at sea lice population when it comes to the consenting process? So ruling out some sites because they are the potential for higher sea lice load than others. Do you have a role in planning and consent?
We have, within the inspectorate, we have three members of staff whose either full time or majority of their time is spent providing comment to planning authorities. One of the considerations with regard to responding to planning consent is considering husbandry, one aspect of which is sea lice, and looking at what the applicant is proposing with regard to sea lice control measures.
Okay, thank you. Emma Roddick.
Thank you. I do just want to pick up on a couple of points there. You've said a few times management of sea lice has improved in Scotland. Have the numbers of sea lice in Scotland gone down significantly?
It's a reasonable question. Yes.
Yes.
I think.
Okay.
And I think that is borne out by the data which is submitted. And also, practically on site, we see almost no epizootics of sea lice, which cause significant physical damage to the stocks. The detrimental effects of sea lice are very, very visible when you get to significant parasite levels.
Yeah.
You will see skin grazed off, particularly the head and along the back. At that point, you actually have a clinical effect of sea lice. You have to bear in mind that sea lice and salmon have evolved together over eons.
Yeah.
But where they get out of control, you see very significant damage. Almost never do we see the effect of that clinical infection.
But the treatment of sea lice does cause impact to the salmon and the environment as well, and on occasion.
I'm going to set aside the environmental impact because, again, that is regulated by SEPA rather than myself. A well commissioned sea lice treatment on clinically healthy animals should have no detrimental effect to them.
Okay, and in terms of managing to reduce sea lice numbers? Are some farms doing that better than others?
I think all do it well. I could give you historical cases where sea lice intervention on individual sites may have trended towards zero. Other sites which have to work harder to control their infestation. So yes, some do better than others.
And given the incidence of no counts and the differences in data collection, do you feel that the data we have is reliable enough to be able to say for sure that we understand what the situation is with sea lice in Scotland?
I have no issue with the data which is presented to me. Not only is it presented weekly, but the farms are also required by dint of the 2008 record-keeping order. They're required to keep a fuller record of sea lice numbers on site, and when we are on site, we will audit the record on site versus the record that's been submitted.
Okay. In terms of farms, you say all are managing their sea lice numbers well. Are any in particular failing to decrease the number?
No, because as your colleague inquired, that would be a failure to demonstrate that the measures in place were satisfactory.
If the number were declared?
Yeah, if they weren't declined.
Okay. And
what we're looking for is a rate of change.
Yeah. So what are some of the challenges then that you face in ensuring robust enforcement, if any?
I don't have a problem with robust enforcement. I do have some concerns with regard to sea lice treatment as carried out. And I say that because there are, we can't consider sea lice in isolation. They infect a population of fish, and your ability to manage the sea lice on the fish is also affected by their physical state, their clinical health. And where we see, for example, significant gill health issues, these fish are more fragile, and some do not tolerate the treatment as well. So either you have a negative clinical effect on the health of the fish, or indeed, ultimately, some of those fish may perish as a result of sea lice treatment. And there's a continual balance being struck between parasite control on one hand and clinical health on the other.
It's really great to hear farms are doing well, sea lice numbers are going down. It's a different story to what others have been telling us the last couple of weeks. Do you have a good grasp on why that might be and why others seem to have a different view of sea lice in Scotland?
This is a personal opinion. Statistics can tell you many, many things, and it depends how you interpret them.
Mm-hmm.
And if you interpret them to tell a particular story, it may be different to a story which is told by others. But I genuinely feel, and I genuinely feel supported by the data, that looking at the sector as a whole, across a long period of time, the sea lice situation has improved in Scotland. And I cannot comment for other people who choose to take a contrary view.
And there aren't any issues from your perspective in being able to identify any issues should they arise with any particular farm not managing their sea lice numbers as well as you would expect them to?
I regulate the industry as a whole without fear or favour. And the industry understand, and I have the power, the inspectorate have the powers to enter a farm at any reasonable time, to inspect records, to inspect stocks. So I am content that the data which is provided is a genuine representation of the stocks on site.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a couple of questions around cleaner fish, but before I go there, I just wanted to pick up a few things on the sea lice issue. I just wanted to just clarify in terms of when you're counting fish in a cage, how many fish do you count?
Bear in mind, it's not the inspector who are carrying out the count. Okay. It's carried out by farm.
How many fish are counted?
Five fish from a minimum of five cages, where the number of cages is equal to or higher than five.
Okay.
Where the number of cages is below five, five fish from all cages.
Okay, so five fish. And in each cage, how many fish are in each cage?
Depends on the size of the cage. It could vary. It's several thousands.
So five fish from several thousand fish in a cage is
yep.
what's counted. So I just wonder there if you have a sense that actually you're really getting meaningful data if you're counting five fish from a thousand.
This is not work that was carried out by me. It was carried out by Crawford Reavy, previously of Strathclyde University, when we introduced the provision of sea louse counts by industry. The question was asked, what is the counting strategy? And Crawford Reavy did the stats, and that is the minimum requirement to achieve a meaningful count. Okay. However, I would offer the observation that was the minimum requirement that was required. You will find that on a weekly basis, fish farmers are counting lice on far more fish for their own management purposes, and where they count more than five fish from five cages, that is the basis on which they provide their average.
Okay. Can you just tell the committee who Crawford Reavy is?
Crawford Reavy is an academic, previously based at Strathclyde University. I believe he is now working in Canada.
Okay. And why would that person have been asked to do that work?
Because he had a particular understanding of the statistics involved in the subject.
Do you think that maybe we need to be reassessing that approach?
I would have no difficulty in asking others to reassess the work. What was correct at the time, I would make the observation, it is likely to still be correct now.
Okay, thank you for that. I just also am interested in to hear from you your thoughts on the Fish Health Inspectorate's case reports that are full of the numbers of salmon dying after physical and chemical sea lice treatments. So you were kind of talking to my colleague Emma Roddick about how fish farming is in a good space, but your own reports are saying that there are large numbers of salmon dying after sea lice treatments.
I think the observation that I made was with regard to sea lice number rather than the number of fish that were dying in treatment. But the rate of mortality in Scottish aquaculture is relatively stable. The causes of mortality vary in time and in space. And any farmers are farmers. They wish their stock to survive and attempt to drive that mortality to its lowest possible. But they are in a conundrum of certainly where you're speaking about losses in treatment. On the one hand, they have a sea lice population that they do not want to burgeon because that will have a negative effect on their stock. So they carry out a treatment. That has a negative effect on their stock. But either way, they will attempt to drive that to the lowest possible measure. And again, looking to the future rather than the past, the introduction of more benign treatment methods, particularly with regard to next generation hydrolysis and the use of freshwater technology.
Just one more thing on the sea lice bit. My understanding is that the salmon farming sector is expanding, and so I just wonder how are we measuring that? We're kind of saying that the numbers are going down, but on the other hand, the farming is expanding. So, do you see what I mean? It's like, have you actually done the sums to know, in absolute terms, if the numbers have actually fallen, given that we're expanding?
Whilst the sector has an aspiration to expand, one which I think I would support with a sustainable framework. If we look at consented tonnage, so consents to produce farmed fish, the consented tonnage is increasing. However, the placing of smolts in the sea and the tonnage which is actually produced is not expanding at the same rate. So they do have increased capacity to produce more, but they do not necessarily utilise all of that consented tonnage.
Okay. I'm going to move on to, you mentioned alternative measures for working with the sea lice, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about cleaner fish. So just in terms of kind of biosecurity, I'd be interested to know if fish, FHI has any views or has made any assessment on the biosafety risks associated with the introduction of wild fish caught wrasse into the salmon aquaculture facilities, and does FHI consider those risks to be lower when farm cleaner fish are used?
The introduction of any fish onto a site changes levels of biosecurity. We would consider the biosecurity of farmed cleaner fish to be subtly different to those of wild cleaner fish. And the reason that I say that is that both the wild cleaner fish and the farmed cleaner fish are raised in home waters. And we know fairly well what the health status of fish in those home waters are. One of the primary reasons for the Fish Health Inspectorate carrying out its health surveillance is actually to support the evidence base upon which the United Kingdom as a whole has approved zone status for significant fish diseases. So we know quite a lot about the health of fish in the wild environment.
Okay, thanks. So on the welfare of wrasse, the REC committee said that there was an urgent need for assessment of the implications of the farming, fishing and use of cleaner fish. I'd be interested to hear from you the welfare of lump and wrasse fish used as cleaner fish in salmon cages and any concerns that you have for them.
I think my primary concern, and I'm on the public record as saying this, is that the mortality which occurs in cleaner fish deployed in aquaculture cages is higher than we would like. All sites where cleaner fish are deployed have a duty of care. When they are deployed on site, they are regarded as aquaculture animals and come under the same control as the primary farmed population. Individual farms will take due regard to the welfare of those fish. They will provide hides for them. Where required, they will provide supplementary feeding. And we do, in occasional cases, see antibiotic treatment directed at the wrasse population. We need to be aware that the Scottish Animal Welfare Committee is currently considering the welfare of cleaner fish in Scotland. And we they're still at the investigation stage, and we await that report.
Okay, thanks for that. You said that the mortalities are higher than you would like. So what level are they at now, and where would you like to see them?
I would like to see, ultimately, where do you want to get mortality to? You want to get it to zero. Mm. However, we live in a practical and real world, and fish do die. But some mortality we have seen over the course of our production cycle. Very significant, over 50% loss.
You're seeing over 50% loss?
Yes.
At the moment?
Not. I wouldn't typify that as everywhere, but we do see losses in excess of 50%, sometimes heading higher. And okay. It is something which does concern me.
Okay. So do you know when the SOC investigation, what's the timeline for that?
There is no date for the publication of the report.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Just following on for that, so you've identified a problem that the fish inspector are concerned about, and that's the use of cleaner fish. Currently, what actions do you take to try and ensure that fish farms are mitigating that issue? What are you actually actively doing to address that concern that you've just recognised?
With regard to the animal welfare, where we see instances which may give us concern with regard to the welfare of the animals, we don't hold the statutory responsibility. We will consult with colleagues in the Animal and Plant Health Agency, where the government veterinarians who do hold the welfare remit reside. So we have a working relationship with veterinarians and AFA.
And finally, in this section, are you satisfied that you have the appropriate staff and financial resources to carry out your function adequately?
It's always useful to have more, but I have to balance my work with efficient use of taxpayers' money. But I can discharge the requirements of the regulation with the staff that I have. You won't hear me say, but I don't have the money. For the regulation that I'm responsible for, I have a suitable number of staff and resource.
Okay, and briefly, Ariane Burgess.
Very briefly, I was interested in understanding in terms of when the inspectorate goes to inspect a farm, how many members of your staff go to carry out that
process? Routinely one.
Just one person?
Yes.
Goes to do that. And what are they actually doing there? Are they going? Yeah.
I mean, there are a number of different things. Farms are authorised under the terms of the Aquatic Animal Health Regulations, and conditions are associated with that authorisation. So we are checking to see that the terms and the conditions of that authorisation have been complied with. We do a certain amount of record checking with regard to sea lice, with regard to movement records, with regard to mortality records. We will look at their veterinary health plans, their biosecurity measures plans. We will go out onto site and physically inspect all the stocks on the site. Primarily what we're looking for there is moribund, sick, abnormally behaving fish. Any evidence which would suggest the presence of a listed disease. In my introduction, I said one of our primary roles is the control of listed disease. So we're permanently surveying for presence, absence, or clinical signs which might suggest the presence of listed disease.
Okay.
We'll also consider, levels of parasites. So making sure that we are what we're seeing in the written record is actually manifested in front of us, that there is no significant, and we're not going to spot small variations in average, but if the farmer has said average is one, you can spot if there's 10, you can spot if there's 2. So what we're looking for is significant difference between written record and physical record.
Okay. And when you when you go to inspect a farm, is it a random check? Is it, do they know you're coming, or do you just show up and then they have to?
Generally, yes. And there are two or three reasons why we would give them notice of attendance. One, we want the right person on site. We need the manager on site. We want them to have records available for us. And three is a very practical reason. We do not, the inspectorate, do not own boats. And bearing in mind that these sites are at sea, we have to be able to get there. At the moment, we are largely reliant on the farmer taking us to and from the site. I have spoken and do speak with the head of operations. And if I had an absolute need, a need on that site tomorrow, I could be put on the tasking list for the captain of ships. That is not something we do as a matter of routine.
OK.
Alan.
Convener, we've talked a bit about the transparency of the data that exists, and you've talked about some of your preferences, I think, around that. I wonder if you can say, firstly, are there any developments to update the Scotland's aquaculture website? And I suppose related to that, are you able to say anything about how the data in the public domain in Scotland compares to perhaps other countries?
With regard to the development of Scotland's aquaculture database, I believe that Professor Griggs, as part of his regulatory review, raised it as a consideration. Obviously, policy colleagues and other parts of government are looking at that review. It's simple for me to say, because I know where everything sits. I think the data which is available is useful. I think it is clearly publicly available. It does not necessarily all sit in one place. Previously, I was asked about resource. You know, if more resource to produce a different IT system were more available, we, the regulators of aquaculture, could make that data more accessible.
I suppose the second part of my question, thank you, the second part is around how that situation that you've described in terms of transparency and data, how that compares with other places.
I don't have any issue with the transparency, and indeed I think in certain regards, we are actually more transparent as a regulator. And the reason that I say that is because every single case which we carry out, a complete case record, so you know, all of the information that we have collected on site, the observations of the inspector, the report which has gone to the farmer, all of that is placed in the public domain.
Okay, thank you.
So, I think in previous inquiries there were interests with regard to mortality publication, sea lice numbers and publication. And I think both of those are addressed as fully as they can be at the moment. The structure and presentation of the data probably could be improved, but accessibility to the data, I personally think that all the data which is collected by the inspectorate is reasonably presented in the public domain.
Thank you.
Thank you. Emma. Eleanor Whittam, beg your pardon.
Thanks, Convener. I'll answer to anything, really. Good morning to you, Charles, this morning. Last week, the committee heard from Professor Sam Martin that normally mortality starts to drop off in the winter time when we have colder waters and colder weather, but more recently we've seen warmer winters, and this has caused higher issues in relation to gill health, causing higher mortality. This is something that the REC committee had already recognised, the serious challenges presented to, due to gill health and disease, particularly in the context of rising sea temperatures. So I'm wondering, based on your surveillance work, are you able to say whether the prevalence of diseases has increased or decreased in recent years with the warmer weather?
I think I would characterise the presence of infection and disease as being a moving, it is a constantly changing situation. But this, the situation that you describe is true. And if we look at the mortality pattern over a number of years, we see a significant peak in the autumn, late summer, autumn months. And rather that being characterised as because the water temperature is high at that point, the peak of that mortality can reasonably be correlated back to the temperature of seas in the previous winter. And what we need to understand and better deal with is that challenge. And I think we are at a point where we will see step changes in the Scottish aquaculture sector, and we will see a far greater use of larger smolts so that they are being put to sea and they are not facing that challenge because their growth cycle will be shortened. I think there are several advantages to that, but one is the reduced opportunity to see that pathogenic effect manifest itself, which is generally manifesting itself in the second summer.
So do you feel as if the data has actually been collected in the way it needs to be collected so that we can start to, the industry itself can start to address the issues, obviously with the input from the Scottish Government? Do you think that we have the data that we need when it comes to looking at climate change and how that's perhaps affecting the temperatures in the sea and how that is impacting upon the aquaculture sector?
Directly with regard to data, the data which is submitted to the inspectorate, we recognise that is not a full data set, but it is all mortality which is considered to be significant and is above, it was an agreed reporting threshold, it doesn't lie in legislation. It was an agreed threshold, agreed with the sector, and was designed to report areas of concern. So we are receiving information on the higher mortality, and that is both temporarily and spatially widespread. So we have a spread of data throughout the year, and we have a spread of data throughout the country, which gives us opportunity to look at trends. It's very difficult to associate absolutely what caused the death, but we can see patterns in, for example, gill disorders, in certain viral diseases, certain bacterial diseases, and how they are affecting the fish through the course of the year.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm interested in how FHI is integrating its evidence around climate change impacts. Mortality rates, as we've started to touch on, at many farms have been extremely high recently, and the two worst performing farms, both at GEA, completed recent production cycles with over 80% total mortality. Coastal Communities Network has calculated from CEPA's figures that 17.5 million farm salmon died at sea in 2022, a million more died in hatcheries. The REC's report recommendation 10 was that there should be a process in place which allows robust intervention by regulators when serious fish mortality events occur. This should include appropriate mechanisms to allow for the limiting or closing down of production until causes are addressed. And their recommendation 9 was that no expansion should be permitted at sites which report high or significantly increased levels of mortalities until these are addressed to the satisfaction of the appropriate regulatory bodies. And I'd be interested to hear from you if it's correct that these recommendations have not been implemented yet.
I think that is a remarkably unfair assessment. I was aware of the comments which were made, and I found them actually personally and professionally hurtful. I felt it was an attack on individual members of staff who spend their full working days providing comments to planning authorities with regard to the appropriateness or otherwise of applicant farm sites. We consider each application under 10 categories. One is location. Two, has it previously been authorised to farm fish? So is it a modification to an existing farm or is it a new farm? We consider its position with regard to disease management area. We would not want to see farms develop in areas which bridge disease management areas. We don't want to see disease management areas join. We would make an assessment of the stocking density, the final stocking density at which fish will be farmed, to make sure it is within identified norms. Because we do know that excessive stocking density is related to disease outbreak. We would consider the husbandry which is being proposed at any site. So that might be sea lice control, mortality removal. Whether or not it is novel in its operation. We would consider specifically the measures in place for the control of sea lice, and we will look at the measures which are being proposed for the containment of the farmed fish. So, you know, I'm sorry, the accusation that we do not in any way consider fish health at the point of an applicant and not provide advice to planning authorities, I'm sorry, but it's just plain wrong.
So you're saying that recommendation 9 and 10 in the rural, in the REC committee's report was wrong?
No, I'm not saying that the recommendation was wrong, but I'm saying that what is done is correct.
Okay. The recommendations are wrong, are not wrong, but...
We do offer the advice.
Okay, that seems a little confusing. So the recommendation of the report is that there should be a process in place which allows robust intervention by regulators when serious fish mortality events occur. So you believe that you provide the advice there?
Sorry, I think we've been talking at cross purposes. I was speaking about the advice which is given to planning authorities.
I was asking specifically about these two recommendations in the REC report, recommendation 10 and recommendation 9. Recommendation 10 is that that there should be a process in place which allows robust intervention by regulators when serious fish mortality events occur. This should include appropriate mechanisms to allow for the limiting or closing down of production until causes are addressed. That's recommendation 10. And then recommendation 9 was that no expansion should be permitted at sites which report high or significantly increased levels of mortalities until these are addressed to the satisfaction of the appropriate regulatory bodies. And what I asked is it the case that these recommendations have not been implemented yet?
First recommendation, the recommendation with regard to either reducing or depopulating in the face of significant mortality. There is not a legislative structure which would allow me to do that. I have legal controls within my grasp which allows me to control and indeed have removed from the water stocks of fish which are suffering from a listed disease. But there is not currently a mandatory requirement for stocks of fish which are suffering from a non-listed disease to be removed from the water.
Okay, so what you're saying is in order for you, for Fish Health Inspectorate to address recommendation 10, you would need more powers?
It would require a change in the law, yes.
Okay. And then recommendation 9, which is around not expanding sites that have significant increased levels of mortalities until they're addressed to the satisfaction of appropriate regulatory bodies, including yourselves.
I'm going to say yes to that for the reasons that we discussed at the start of my answer with regard to what we offer the planning authority. Ultimately, it is the planning authority who decide whether or not to permit modification or farming in a new area. But where there has been significant mortality in a farm that has sought modification to the site, what we have seen is councils, and I'm thinking particularly of a case in Loch Fyne, where the equipment was allowed, it was permitted to change the equipment and increase the volume of that equipment, but the application was conditioned that it would not result in an increase in held biomass.
Okay, so it sounds to me like you see your role is as for recommendation 9 is providing information to the local planning authority, and then it's kind of their responsibility to decide whether expansion can be permitted or not based on the information they get. You kind of give them the information that something's going on in the site, and then it's up to them.
Ultimately, the decision to change either change the permitted equipment or for a new site to be granted, that is not a decision which the inspectorate take. That is a decision that the council or the planning authority makes based on the information which is provided by a number of consultees.
Yes. So even if you see... Okay.
We're going to have to move on. We're very short of time. Rhoda Grant.
Can I just ask a question around climate change and the impact that can have? We heard recently about micro jellyfish that are causing real problems for fish farms. How do you monitor the impacts of climate change, and what advice can you give to fish farmers? Is there any science in this area? There's obviously concerns about fish health.
I need to be careful with the advice that I give to farmers, that I restrict it to legislative matters for which I'm responsible. I have been advised by sector management at times that what I'm offering is business advice rather than advice on legislative matters. However, I have a good working relationship with veterinarians and managers within the farming sector. What we saw with regard to micro jellyfish was a rapid northward advancement of a species of micro jelly which hadn't previously been seen in Scottish waters. It would normally lie, its northern boundary would normally lie somewhere at the approaches to the English Channel. So we are seeing changes in the environment, and we are seeing the emergence of new pathogens, whether they are micro jellyfish, and we will consider to see the emergence of pathogens, parasites and pests which we haven't seen before because our environment is changing. But what we may also see is somewhat of our traditional diseases, if traditional is the right word, that have previously caused issue. I'm thinking here particularly of cold water vibriosis and winter sores. It may well be that with warming water, the significance of those diseases themselves will actually diminish. So what we are seeing is a changing environment, but not all impacts will be negative.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just very aware, I've got it, just like you've got a duty of care for the fish that you inspect, I've got a duty of care for my witnesses. So I'm aware that we're quickly running out of time. So if I could ask members to try and keep their questions as succinct as possible. I've got a brief supplementary from Emma Harper, then moving on to a further question from Rhoda Grant.
Thanks, Convener. I will be brief. Last week, Professor Simon McKenzie said there were no research cage facilities in Scotland. So when you're doing research, you're comparing site A, B and C, which have different environments, different conditions. So he felt that made it difficult to make research conclusions. Do you have a comment about why we don't have research cage facilities in Scotland, and should we have?
We have had in the past. There has been a site close to Skye which operated mainly as a feed trials unit, but it operated for a good number of years as a feed trial unit. Is there a reason not to do so? No. Are there reasons that it hasn't happened so far? In my head, yes. And generally it runs with regard to ownership and operation. Somebody has to apply for it, be responsible for it, and run it. But it's been discussed for a number of years, and it remains a point of discussion. And indeed, it came up in a sector discussion, I think, last week, with regard to a desire to have a trials facility. It's previously, often you will see it referred to as an innovation site. Where they could perhaps trial innovative equipment or possibly see where the boundaries are with regard to appropriate sizing of site. But they're quite challenging to run and quite expensive. So, you know, there is no reason why it couldn't happen. It's just the right consortium possibly hasn't yet formed. Previously, you know, there is research carried out across the world into aquaculture and salmon aquaculture. So we often rely on research which is carried out elsewhere and extrapolated to Scotland.
So it could run in tandem with the National Aquaculture Technology Hub in Stirling, maybe?
Potentially. But fine, you know, I would imagine it would run with a series of partners. And it's identifying the right partners, bringing them together, and in an enabling environment, which is challenging at times.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. Environmental standards on medicine use have been tightened since the REC committee report, and I wonder if you've seen a reduction in testing of medical residues since that tightening took place?
I think the simple answer is yes. I mean, I'm not regulatory responsible for monitoring medicine usage in the Scottish aquaculture arena, but I would look at reports from RUMA, responsible use of medicines in agriculture. And they made an observation with regard to antibiotic usage, that the amount of antibiotic had reduced compared to 2020 and 2021. These reductions were observed both in freshwater and seawater. And the use of antibiotics in aquaculture is relatively small compared to its use in other animal production sectors. around 1.5% of freshwater farms reporting usage and 8.7% of marine farms. But in any discussion that I have with regard to antibiotic usage, which can be quite a polarised debate, antibiotics are useful and we should not be shy to use them where they're required. And there is a veterinary adage, use them as little as possible, but where you need to use them as much as you require to provide that clinical effect, which at the end of the day, what you want to do is rid your animal population of an infection.
And just as a, have you seen any impact of that tightening of regulation on fish health, or has fish health remained the same since those regulations changed?
You have to bear in mind that I've been in the industry for an awfully long time and I've seen the emergence and disappearance of technologies. And I think the biggest single impact, positive impact, that has taken place to support fish health in the last decades is the development of effective vaccines. If you look back to the 1990s, furunculosis, a bacterial disease, the impact was incredibly significant. But an effective vaccine was developed in the 1990s and still remains effective to today. So the continual development of vaccination for diseases that we know are likely to occur is the single biggest benefit and the single biggest impact in reducing medicine usage in Scotland. And indeed, we invited the Chief Scientific Advisor for Scotland to the Farm Fish Health Framework a number of months ago. And an outcome of that was her facilitating a meeting with the major pharmaceutical companies to try and stimulate additional vaccine development. And other recommendation was to take that discussion into other fora to try and provoke international interest in vaccine development. Because we have to bear in mind that, you know, we're not looking at Scotland in isolation. These are issues which are affecting salmon farmers across the world.
You haven't seen a negative impact in the tightening of the regulation around medicines?
It's not necessarily the tightening of the regulation. It's responsible usage.
Thank you. That leads us on to a question from Beatrice Wishart.
The committee has heard concerns about that the use of chemicals has increased since 2018. So what does your monitoring tell you about the trends in the amount of medicines and chemicals used since that time? And has the availability of data and analysis improved to provide a better picture all round?
I'm going to deflect that question. I would redirect that question to SEPA when you have them in evidence session. It is SEPA rather than ourselves who regulate medicine and treatment use in Scotland.
Okay.
A supplement from Emma Harper and then Ariane Burgess.
I'm conscious of time, convener, so I'm quite happy to pass on to other colleagues.
Okay, thank you.
Me too.
Okay, a question from Emma Roddick.
Thank you. Just very briefly, kind of on breaches related to medicine use in fish farms, do you feel that enforcement is where it needs to be on that particular issue?
I do. And I only base that on my observation with regard to the work we do with the Veterinary Medicines Directorate. Their survey is looking at medicine residue presence in fish flesh.
Okay.
So both permitted substances, but above permitted level. They look for environmental contaminants and they look for medicines which are not permitted for use in fish. And we collect the samples, they do the analysis. If there is a follow-up required, i.e. they've detected something which shouldn't be there, we then carry out the follow-up action. And it is, I couldn't actually tell you the last year where we carried out an investigation on an unexplained residue.
So you haven't done it recently?
No.
Okay, thank you. Question from Ariane Burgess.
Is this 15?
Yes, 13.
I've got that as Emma. No, I don't have another.
Okay, that's fine. Eleanor Whittam.
Thanks, Convener. I have a great interest in the welfare of our wild Scottish salmon. I know you've already answered to my colleague Ariane Burgess that whilst you don't have any locus in their health, you do have responsibility for ensuring compliance with the reporting requirements for fish farm escapes. So whilst it's a very complex picture as to why we have our wild salmon populations decreasing, and I accept that, I'm wondering whether you think that the number of fish farm escapes is being recorded accurately, and whether there's any need to strengthen the current sanctions and fines available, or do you think that they are appropriate? That was too many questions in one, I suppose, wasn't it?
I ended up focusing on your sanction.
That's probably the thrust of my question, though, round about the sanction regime that you are responsible for in terms of looking at the numbers of escapees and how they're reported. Is that strong enough?
There are a number of different responsibilities. The 2007 Act gave us powers to carry out inspections to judge the suitability of measures in place for the containment of fish, the prevention of escape of fish, and any measures which are in place to recapture fish where they do escape, and judge their suitability or otherwise. Where they are deemed to be not satisfactory, similarly to sea lice, there is a regulatory process by which we would issue an enforcement notice. Non-compliance with the enforcement notice is an offence. Secondly, there is a requirement on fish farmers to report any occurrence of escape and any circumstance which may have given rise to the suspicion of an escape. So not only where fish have escaped, but where fish might have escaped. Reported escapes are stochastic in nature. They come and they go. You know, they occur or they don't. What is apparent from the work that my colleagues in Freshwater Laboratory have done is that there is evidence of interbreeding between farm fish and wild fish. It's very hard to work out how it has occurred in the absence of any reported escape incident. And also, as part of the wild fish catch statistics, there is consideration of the number of escapee farm fish which crop up in the wild environment. And the number reported is actually remarkably small. And I always query, we've had escapes, we know we've had escapes, but they do not crop up in the wild catch. But there is one other consideration, is that in young salmon, there is a condition known as precocious par. And these are fish which are only this size, but they're actually sexually mature, and they never run to sea. And you see the same thing in wild fish. And is it an impact of these precocious par breeding? I don't know. There's more work to be done to understand the introgression of farmed genes into the wild population. With regard to your last question, whether or not sanctions are appropriate, I will apply the sanctions which are in legislation. It's not for me to make a judgment as to whether or not the punishment is suitable for the non-compliance.
Okay, thank you.
Emma Roddick.
Thanks. Just briefly around escapes, I'd like to understand a little bit more what farms can do to mitigate the risk of fish escaping.
There are some things that farms can mitigate for, and there are some things which farms can't mitigate for. As part of the planning consent, or application for planning consent, one of the very big things that we do look at is the design of the farm and the specification. And we are looking at that specifically to consider containment. So make sure that there is a good understanding of what meteorological and hydrographical impacts there may be on any site, and taking advice from suitably qualified people as to whether or not the moorings and equipment are suitable to contain fish under those circumstances. And generally, I would say that the Scottish aquaculture sector has got a good record on containment. The difficulty is that farms are large, and where something systemic goes wrong, the loss of containment can be significant. And the purpose of the regulation is to make sure that the measures which are in place for the containment of the fish are suitable. But absolutely, you know, what can be planned for is planned for. But you can't plan for the bizarre. I think it was off Col where a wild tuna swam straight through the side of a cage. You can't plan for that, and you can't spec a farm cage to cope with that kind of insult. And whilst you can reasonably plan for expected weather, and normally we plan for a 1 in 100 year event, weather events far in excess of what your farm is specified for will catch you foul.
Okay. We have had calls to increase quite significantly the sanctions available to farms when escapes happen. Do you think that would be justified in the case where an escape has happened due to a lack of potential mitigation measures being taken?
That decision is for others, and I would apply whatever sanction government feels is appropriate to the impact. But largely what you see in developing a sanction is you would look at impact, and where you can demonstrate significant impact, then perhaps sanctions should also be significant. But as I say, it's not a decision for me, that would be a decision for others.
Just very briefly, what's your position, and are you aware of advancements in research to look at breeding fish that are infertile, which would reduce the potential impact of wild fish, farm fish interactions in the event of escapes?
Yes. And it's not new. When I first joined the laboratory, there was work to look at triploiding of Atlantic salmon. And as an aside, it's very routinely used in rainbow trout for both for farming for table purposes and for restocking. But it's not done to reduce the risk of inbreeding. It's done because if you remove the requirement for the animal to sexually mature, then the energy which is put into sexual maturation is put into growth. And it works really quite well in rainbow trout. But in Atlantic salmon, the triploid fish performed well in the freshwater phase, but were really quite poor in performance in comparison to normal diploid fish in the marine environment. And if if two parallel populations of fish were challenged, the triploid population would come off worse than the diploid population. But yes, I am aware of work which has been done in the past, and occasionally, you know, folk are still looking at it.
OK, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'd be interested to hear what enforcement powers you have to ensure that fish farms have the appropriate measures in place around the containment of fish.
It's largely similar to the enforcement measures that we have with regard to sea lice. We would look at the measures that are in place for the containment of fish, the prevention of escape of fish, and where fish do escape, the recapture of escaped fish, and whether or not the measures which are in place are satisfactory. Where measures are deemed not to be satisfactory, we would go through again the same process. We would offer advice, formal warning, and move to enforcement notice. And these powers have been applied, particularly with regard to the state of net pens that didn't appear to be being well maintained. We were informed that new pens were on order, but we were suitably concerned about the state of the nets, that they sought replacement of nets from elsewhere. We didn't get as far as issuing a formal enforcement notice because they'd actually taken the corrective action prior to the enforcement notice being
issued. When an enforcement notice is given, how often do you do that in the course of a year? Or?
With regard to containment, very, very rarely. Mm-hmm. What's the primary driver? There is no benefit to a farmer to allow his stock to escape. And it's a bit like allowing fish to die. People, it's not something that they do. It is as a consequence of something unusual occurring. It's very rare that we would formally enforce with regard to containment.
Thanks for that. And when you do issue an enforcement notice, what's the kind of process that the farm has to? Is there a timeline they have to respond to?
What we would normally do is offer a timeline, which is, you know, if it's something simple, the timeline will be short. If it's something more complicated, they will be given more time to comply. And it depends on individual circumstances.
Okay. And just in terms of all the regulatory public bodies, do you have a sense that everyone is clear about the roles that they have in terms of enforcement?
Yes.
So you know the space that you work in. I think I've heard that already today, that you're very clear about where your boundaries are.
I'm comfortable in my regulatory space. Mm-hmm. I have general understanding of the requirements of other regulators. And you know, there is information which is traded between regulators. Mm-hmm. You know, if I come across something which I think is of significant concerns with regard to welfare, I will take it to AFA. If it's with regard to the environment, I'll take it to SEPA.
Okay.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Can I ask about new technologies and what is happening with them, such as enclosed cages?
To repeat the question, I didn't hear it.
Yeah. Can I ask about new technologies and the impact they may have, such as enclosed cages, on land cages? Things like that, will that have an impact on fish health? Could that mitigate against some of the problems we're seeing now? And I suppose referring back to kind of the lack of really experimental cages and the like in Scotland.
If I split your question in, I think three. Both with regard to semi-contained and contained technologies. Many people see them as a panacea, and they're contained. Therefore, no fish escape, no disease gets in, and everything lives. Everything survives, and it's harvested at a premium weight and sold at a premium price.
The reality is actually really quite different. I'm not going to say that the problems are the same. They have different problems, but you know, the challenges are different. Water quality issues can be really quite significant. So what we do, what we have seen across the world, is not particularly a difference in final performance. We have limited experience in Scotland, I'll be honest. We have experience of recirculating aquaculture in the freshwater phase of salmon production, so production of smolts for on-growing at sea. We have had one or two attempts, and I would characterise them as no more. They did not perform well. And we are in discussion with a new developer who is looking to establish semi-contained equipment in seawater. I think there are opportunities, but there are also challenges.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you. And really just related to that, specifically on regulation, does regulation need to get ahead of these scenarios, or is consideration, in your view, I know it's maybe not your responsibility, but do you think there's a need for regulation to anticipate these new technologies, and if not, is the regulation adequate in your view just now?
I think the current regulation will probably dovetail quite well into their operation. And you know, why do I say that? You know, largely the concerns will be the same. It will be containment. It will be parasites. It will be listed disease. It will be environmental impact. It will be welfare. How the relative balances are, we might see differences. But the absolute challenges and requirement to address by legislation, it may well be that you need changes to things like planning consent, because the structures are very, very different to what you're used to. But with regard to the health control, environmental control, although the challenges are different, the demands will be similar.
Thank you. Edward Mington.
Thank you very much, Convener. Charles, I'll just go back to a comment in a question to Emma Roddick asked. She asked if sea lice numbers were reducing across Scotland, and your answer was yes. Can I just confirm that you are talking purely about farm salmon in that case?
I am purely talking about farm salmon.
Thank you for clarifying that. The diseases that are prevalent, amoebic gill disease, infectious salmon anemia, cardiomyopathy syndrome, and the increasing numbers of jellyfish, those are continuing to increase on an annual basis, aren't they, the mortality from those?
Can I make a correction to you first?
Yes.
Your reference to infectious salmon anemia? No.
So we can take that one out?
We can take that one out.
Amoebic gill disease, cardiomyopathy and jellyfish are all increasing. Deaths from them are increasing across Scotland.
The number of individual fish which perish due to each of those diseases has increased.
Okay. So as a general point, as a very generalisation, the last full mortality figures that I got were 36,000 tonnes of fish died in 2022, which was 25% of the population by estimates of fish that had gone to sea. Do you see that number as a figure against the amount of production there was? The production hadn't really gone up, but fish deaths had gone up. Is that not a fair assumption?
They're not my figures, and what you're referring to there is tonnage.
Yes.
What we have seen in recent years, not necessarily that the rate of mortality has changed. The rate of mortality
as judged by survival to harvest, is remarkably constant. It sits, you know, we can argue about points, but it sits around 75%. So around 75% of fish which move to harvest, that are put to sea, survive to harvest. So the mortality rate is fairly steady. However, what we have seen is a change in the age at which fish die. So, you know, 25% of a small biomass is a relatively small number. But if you grow those fish for an extra year and then they die, the same number of fish have died, but the tonnage increases because they're a year older.
So bigger fish are dying?
Bigger fish are dying.
Well, that gives me confidence. So the final question, it doesn't matter to me what age they die at, it's the fact that they're dying. His recommendation 9 of the REC committee report says that there should be no expansion on the basis that mortalities are too high across the whole sector. So recommendation 9 is not being enforced at all, because mortality stayed the same, was too high when this report was published in 2019, and there's been expansion on the industry, is what you're saying.
The consented biomass, which the industry have accessible to grow fish, but if you look at the number of fish which are put to sea...
Stayed the same.
Largely.
And the same amount have died. So it's all exactly the same as it was in 2019.
It is.
I think that's the answer to my question, then. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I've got one very final question relating to Recommendation 17. And the previous committee suggested that a review of the compliance policy needed to be undertaken and be effective. And it would have to be robust, enforceable, and include appropriate penalties. Can you tell me what or highlight any powers that have changed in the FHI since 2018?
The biggest change in power is with regard to sea lice and sea lice number collection.
Okay. Any other powers that you've seen changed since then?
Yeah, that's the big one.
Okay. Any other questions? No. Well, thank you very much. That was a mammoth session, and we really appreciate the extra time that you've been able to give us. Certainly delved into the topic very well. So thank you very much. I'm now going to move on to our next item of business, which is consideration of a negative instrument, the Seed Fees Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. Do members have any comments to make on this instrument? No. Well, thank you. That concludes our business in public today, and we will now move into private session.